We're going home. Heading for Toronto Airport, a hotel appears just as the systems start to shut down as the battery flattens completely. Within earshot of the flight paths, fortunately it's close enough to be within easy commuting of our final gateway to home. With some prompting from me, Bernard asks the receptionist if there's a senior or over 50 rate.
You certainly don't look it,
she answers, as we confirm that, yes, we are. It seems our feeling of decrepitness is not really due to any aspect of visibly advancing old age, but more to do with completing over 25,000 miles perched on a motorcycle for a year. Her response leaves us strangely mollified as our knees crack loudly, following her towards our room without the aid of Zimmer frames, but only just. The room is cavernous, and as I orient myself, the door opens and closes intermittently, while Bernard trundles in and out, delivering wash bags, clothes, computers, and anything else needed for our final assault on getting home. Hopefully, it will happen before qualifying for the second level advanced severe old age discount. Taking a taxi to find a solar charger to retrieve poor Bertha's battery from where she's descended. I'm not starting, I've had enough, and you cannot make me. An hour later, we're back at the hotel. Clutching assorted leads and the life-giving panel, everything is connected before praying she will start the following day. Thankfully, the sun works its magic by then, and she fires up first time. Phone calls lead us to Air Canada, and 8 hours later, all the paperwork is done and Bertha weighs in at 330 kilograms, while a very nice dangerous goods certificate is extracted from a lovely man who even comes in on the national holiday of Canada Day, the 1st of July, to sign off the bike. After shipping a bike by air so many times, it's apparent we're all talking the same language, and he declares himself happy. Meanwhile, our constant companion, the carnet, is stamped by a customs officer, who tells how he has always wanted to take his Harley around the world. Shaking hands with us, he comments,
"Jesus, you two make it sound so easy,"
as he asks about the journey and how we've solved this and that problem. "It's easy," Bernard replies, "if you really want to do it." Pakistani and Croatian security staff come over to talk to us as Bertha is readied for her final flight, and they ask how we found their countries. Holding my breath, I wait for Bernard to say something like, "Head east from England," but he resists and tells them how much we loved them. The Croatian has not been home for many years and is interested in how his fledgling homeland has developed since the war that finished during the early 1990s. He hears of all the new hotels and of how it's now obviously a tourist haven for Italians who nip across the 160-kilometre watery gap called the Adriatic Sea. "And Pakistan?" the second officer asks quietly. Of all the countries visited, this one place always presents the most questions from all over the world, as people had thought us mad going there. Bernard answers him honestly for the both of us. "We loved Pakistan, we truly did. The people were lovely and everybody, and I mean everybody, was so helpful." The officer is pleased with our thoughts on his home country, as his voice displays pleasure, coming through clearly as we talk about where, how and when our wheels had passed through this troubled country. Telling him how we wish the country nothing but peace for the future, Bernard finishes with the Islamic term Inshallah, or God willing. "It's our wish for the ordinary people of Pakistan and for people everywhere in times of trouble." 3 hours later, we're standing at Toronto Airport trying to work out how to pay for the 11:30 p.m. flight, as our credit and debit cards have been locked out by the UK banks again, the fourth time on the trip so far. In the end, a very complicated transaction is done with a bureau de change, but it was probably in their interest to help us. Otherwise, Bernard may well have destroyed their ATM with frustration. At 11:20, we're sitting on the Air India flight to London, heaving a sigh of relief as we settle in for the way home. Weeks late, and with a malfunctioning bike again. We start to think about the end, and of so much that has happened. Of the good times, the bad times, and every shade in between. As the plane rises into the sky, we know it's been a journey of start, stop, go, start, stop, go, involving periods of both intense activity and inactivity, as we looked to keep moving ever onwards. Recollections flow of shivering for 3 weeks in eastern Turkey, waiting for the Iranian visa refusal saga. Yes, no, yes, to be resolved. And of how my 50-plus friend sitting beside me had somehow become a threat to Iranian national security. From bank lockouts, 4, to breakdowns, 5, it's easy to recall how each stop caused the leakage of time and funds. The hemorrhaging of finances struck us hard, very hard, as the pound went into freefall with the international financial meltdown hitting the world. It often left Bernard holding his head in his hands as 25% of our budget disappeared in exchange rates, while he ruminated on the chance of it happening now, right now, after 2 years of planning and 30 years of waiting. My thoughts shift from shocking roads through to all the wonderful people we came into contact with. Sometimes I marvel, no, that's the wrong word, I'm left incredulous how it's possible to traverse the planet on a bike, seemingly so simply, with barriers broken down as they were encountered. Sitting in the UK, so long ago it now seems, we wanted to spread the thought that many things are possible if you have the will to face an adventure. Within this journey, it cannot be anything else but true that you have to face your own fears, hopes, and beliefs. It's also true there can be no sense of adventure without an element of risk, which won't happen in the comfort of security. If I'd stayed in this zone, then it would never have been possible to show how a blind person, with the right assistance, can have fantastic adventures. The same is true whether or not disabilities are involved, as you have to be willing to take a chance or opportunity when it presents itself. Through it all, the assistance I received from the man on my left, who's now fast asleep, is incalculable. It's probably so far beyond most people's perception of what is involved in working with a blind person that it will pass by largely unnoticed. It's the way he prefers it anyway, as we both know what occurred, and it's probably impossible to truly transmit it by the spoken word. To him, he merely set out to fulfil his own lifelong dream, to seek an answer to the question, could I do it? After all, people can spend their life wondering if they're made of the right stuff for things such as this. Now, he knows. We've all read about people doing such things, and they become something different in the telling of the story, something unique or exceptional. In reality, they too are just like us. Frightened, hungry, cold, wet, insecure, happy, sad. They continue to push their way through what they've set themselves in the best way they can. Like all these people Bernard had read about across his entire life, now he has his own answer to that question. Never again does he have to wonder about the answer. It's my own belief that only a very small number of people would have ever contemplated this venture with a blind woman. Many people did question his sanity for taking me on such a journey, and their thoughts simply left him shrugging his own shoulders when he phrased his own question to them. Well, why not? Over the miles, we were to become two people blended into one, in thought, emotion, and even written words. Even as he stressed and worried about being able to fix the bike or ride the roads encountered, never once did any thought cross my mind other than confidence. It's a rare state of mind indeed, given everything encountered. In all our time spent together, 24 hours a day for a year, the greatest compliment I can remember is how people noticed we liked each other. And more. Much more. Bernard has always said that liking somebody is not the same as loving them, as you can love without liking, and you can like without loving. We're truly fortunate in that we have both sides of the coin. A year on the road has reinforced these thoughts even further. My mind replays thoughts and images as I sit beside my now sleeping co-conspirator as the plane flies through the night. Feelings and emotions flow through my mind, seeing me climbing elephants in the jungles of Nepal, stroking tigers in Thailand, and cuddling koalas in Australia. It relives meeting wonderful people from all around the world who work with blind and partially sighted people, often under difficult circumstances. From Bruno of Swiss Guide Dogs to George Abraham in India, from Seeing Hands in Nepal to Vision Australia. They all appear in my mind. Across the miles, many places have become linked to the everyday people we spent time with, from Slobodan in Montenegro to Hector in Peru with his Mr. Smith greetings. Glenn in Australia reappears in my mind, along with the 3 hours sitting in the dust of the Nullarbor as Bertha was repaired. I think of his upset at the end when he realised I was blind and I wanted to hug him and tell him it was all right. Voices echo through my mind in memory of so many of them, strangers becoming friends with our brief passing through their lives. Indians, Pakistanis, Greeks and people from all over the world settle onto a Scottish wagon driver called Gordon, whose advice resounded many times in my head when we were lost. Follow the wagons. My legs relive harsh mountain climbs, and my body feels events across the world as images continue to flow. The jolt of bad roads, the feel of the bright sun, the dryness of my mouth, the feel of the wind, the noise, the worry, the ecstasy, the fear. All collide in a welter of emotions as I replay and work through what it all means, if ever this is possible. Our friend Bertha is battered and misbehaving, although intact as we wing eastwards on the 7-hour flight. Over the miles, only once did we fall off, thankfully without any injuries. I've stood among the clouds at nearly 15,000 feet, struggling to breathe and shivering in the snow, before gasping in the heat of the lowlands. Enduring each and every day with humour, roads that were made of mud, gravel, rock and tarmac, and sometimes all at the same time. We survived. Clattering and rattling across landscapes for which Bertha was never built. Objects were dodged, be they cattle, kangaroos, chasing dogs, or trees which had fallen and blocked our way. We've encountered routes blocked due to protests, turmoil and political instabilities, the likes of which we'd never before experienced. It's small wonder that many people try to come to our own homeland when you understand how they struggle with daily life. While existence is undoubtedly hard in some countries we pass through, it's also a fact that within the poorest, we often found the greatest welcome. It seems to be a universal truth. The kindness often starts at borders of such places, where guards helped us through unfamiliar processes while Bernard stressed. The acts of kindness extended to riot police who opened their ranks in Malaysia to let us through as the protesting crowd fell silent as they watched us pass. When times were hard or we were frightened, it was a matter of persevering, as people often do. Yes, it was frightening at times, and Bernard will readily admit to it, as only a fool is not afraid. It's what keeps us alive. "Let's get this thing done," was his saying, his motto, his mantra when things had to be done. Over our time on the road, I recall many such sayings as things became physically, psychologically, or emotionally difficult. Other mantras, such as "control the fear or it will control you," is another long-remembered voice urging me to tough it out in the crossing of India, while his own hands shook long after the bike had stopped. Sometimes he would shout at himself before setting off again, desperately trying to keep us in one piece, alive through each day. Only twice did he have a crisis in relation to his own abilities. Once in the darkness of Lahore in Pakistan, and then again on the road to Gorakhpur, as we choked on the white dust and chaos of India. Both these times are burned into his and our brains. Such is the way when your self-belief and self-image are teetering on the edge of a precipice. You hang on by your fingernails, as you cannot afford to fall. Other people, me, depended on him, and he knew this. Times like this, and others, left me like a frightened rabbit for weeks later, and it shaped how we both dealt with our fears. Mantras ruled at times, as there was little other help, only each other's support to depend on. It was enough, and this became even truer as we moved on through time and distance. My thoughts drift to my late husband Peter, of what he would make of me now. In all probability, he would never recognise the person I've become, both with this journey and with the passing of time and life across those lonely years. I like to believe he's sitting somewhere saying, "Good on you, Cath. Live life. Make each day count." I've tried to do just that, and nowhere has this been truer than over the last year. If you're reading this tale of two ordinary people just like you, then there's something you should always remember and hold dear to you. You never know when it will all end. It can be so sudden and so unexpected that there's no warning, no further time to say the things you've never said to those around you. This second, right now, is your opportunity to put the book down and correct that omission. Take it now. You may never have another chance. Life is like that. The hours pass by, with all these thoughts of the 26,385 miles eventually covered. Thoughts of life, love, and the people I've known and met. The plane hums and banks across the Atlantic, taking me towards my guide dog Biscuit and everything else that life has to offer me in the years ahead. The knowledge that, truly, each day does count and shall be made to count is my precious gift to you. Some people may well understand this already with startling clarity. They, like me, know the days are not infinite, but must all eventually end, much like our own journey through this fantastic world and our friend Bertha. My reverie is disturbed as Bernard stirs beside me, slowly waking, stretching, taking in where he is. Words are no longer necessary between us as my hand reaches for his. Fingers gently interlock and squeeze to say hello. It's all we need to say. We're going home.